Okay, so today is John's birthday. Let me try it. Okay, so today is John's birthday. Yes. So how old are you today, John?
I'm 87 today.
87 today. So you gotta look at the camera.
Oh, yeah.
You gotta look at the camera.
Definitely.
All right. So we thought it would be fun for his birthday to talk about the 1950s.
Right.
So we've got our 1950s decor here. Mm-hmm. We've got our jukebox.
Yes,
we've got our 50s clothes. So how old were you in the early, John's going to talk about the early part of the 1950s?
From 1950 to 1954.
So how old were you?
I was 16 at 1950.
Okay.
Just a young lad.
Just a young lad.
Okay,
and so you grew up in Cuba, but where were you in 1960?
In 1950, I was in Madison, Wisconsin. We'd come there 3 years earlier, and I was in the class of 1951. At Central High School, right in the center of town, right down from the Capitol.
Okay, so was this like, did you go to malt shops like this?
I went to one of the malt shops on Park and University.
Yeah.
And also, I really liked the root beer place, you know, where you can go over and get the frosted glasses and have root beer floats.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you got on a Letterman sweater here?
Yes, I do. I had a letter in tennis.
Okay.
Yeah, I was on the tennis team. I was the number one player on that tennis team, but it was a very poor tennis team. It wasn't the greatest compared to the other two high schools.
What were some of the other sports you did?
Well, I was in gymnastics a lot.
Gymnastics.
I used to go to Turner Hall, which is a German gymnastics club, and was there all the time with my friends. And I did a pretty good job in gymnastics.
Did you do diving too?
I did some diving. Again, this is sort of low-level diving. I competed in the B.B. Clark beach contest, and I think there were two persons doing the diving, and I think I got first or second place.
Yeah.
You know, given two people in it.
Given two people? That's pretty good, huh?
Yeah, it's pretty good. So that's what happened.
No, seriously, he was a pretty good diver.
Yeah.
Even when I met him and he was older, he was able to do jackknives.
Yeah, backflips and everything.
Yeah, he's a good diver. Very good swimmer. Did you used to swim when you lived in Madison?
Oh, all the time. We'd go over to the lake. Lake Mendota, we'd swim from pier to pier all summer long.
Okay.
Yeah, down to the university and then on to the other parts of the lake shore.
Okay. And here we have some little 50s music in the background. What kind of music did you listen to when you were?
Well, I wasn't very musical compared to most people. And I just remember just the tunes, just the very good tunes.
Yeah.
I really don't remember much of the different people, but there was it was the time of Dick Contino and the accordion music. I was big on. That's another thing I did. I played the accordion with 120 bass accordion, and I played in Soldier's Field with 3,000 people.
And you played what?
We played Caballero Santa.
There you go.
Yeah, and every Saturday I was on WKOW as part of the backup band, as we had yodeling and all kinds of things for the population in Wisconsin.
Okay, and I think you did some dancing too, didn't you?
Yeah, a little bit of dancing. I wanted to dance. I took classes when I went to the senior prom and learned all the dances. All the regular ballroom dances, and it was a lot of fun. In fact, Susan and I started doing more dancing this last year before the COVID.
Yeah, but he always had a big leg up on me about that, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
He's always a good dancer, so it was nice that he got to take those lessons.
Yeah.
And you did some tap dancing too, didn't you?
Yeah, one time I went down to Turner Hall, and the guy there knew some tap dancing, so he taught me a couple of tap dances too, very simple ones, but it was a lot of fun learning one more form of dance. I was always learning dance, and when I went to Cornell University, I joined the dance club, and really had classes and was on stage. It was a big thing.
So were you a good student in high school or not so much?
Honor roll. Honor roll all the way through. In fact, I would have had straight A's if I hadn't gotten some B's in gym. Yeah, I was on the high honor roll, and then Mr. Rooney finally gave me A's. Yeah, it's sort of funny.
That's pretty good. Yeah. So you had some community service involvement too, didn't you?
Yeah, we were very active in community service. I was on the youth council. I was on the human relations committee, and my big project was a Halloween project called. It's called The Trick is a Treat. And we collected clothes, a whole city collected clothes around Madison to send them to Korea, because Korea was going in bad shape at that time and people needed help. And the big thing was we had the clothes, we didn't know how to get them to Korea, but the Navy came through and took them over there.
That's good.
That was a good thing.
So then, where did you go to college?
I went to Cornell University in New York.
No, where'd you go before that?
Yeah, well, before that, oh, that's right. We got to start back to Deep Springs. I went to Deep Springs College. We had a very unusual school, about 20 students. And we stayed there 3 years, and the idea was to listen to the voice of the desert and develop spiritually, as well as taking the classes. Now, it wasn't just we were just monks or anything like that, but it was all male, and they had an alky-nicky policy. There was to be no alcohol and nicotine in the valley. This is a big valley in Northern California, near Bishop, and the place was called Deep Springs. It was a lot of fun.
I'm gonna move
going there. Quite an honor, too,
yes,
being chosen. My counselor in high school.
Well, said, how many people were in your class?
Seven.
Seven?
Yeah.
How many people were in the whole college?
20.
20.
Yeah, different.
20.
But a lot of cows
20.
And cattle.
So, I mean, it was a bit of a privilege to get to go.
It was
a
privilege.
Yes.
It still is. Now it's up to 36, and I keep following what they're doing out there. It's a magnificent experience.
So was it just like you went to school and took classes and stayed in the house or something?
We had
a sorority.
We had a work program. I took care of the pigs. I took care of the chicken. I used to ride. I had two horses while I was there. At different times, and I used to ride the range and bring in the cows from the mountains. That was quite a big task, and it was
chickens. Were there chickens?
Yeah, chickens. I took care of a lot of chickens.
A lot of chickens.
Yeah, 300 chickens.
And so, like in your day, like you'd get up and go to school, but first you'd do like chickens or what?
Oh yeah, you have to get up early for the chickens, and then feed them in the morning, and then feed them at night, or take care of them, check them.
But what did your day look like?
Oh, the day you take care of the chickens, then you have your breakfast, because we had, and then we had classes with about 4 or 5 people in each class, and or maybe 8, depending upon the teacher. We had a rotation of teachers coming through the place, and it was an interesting experience in all. And we sort of all are Deep Springers forever the rest of our lives. Yeah.
So that's quite an experience.
Quite an experience.
Now, how many years was that?
It was 3 years. Now it's down to 2, but we were there 3 years.
For 3 years?
They wanted it really to sink in.
But it wasn't really a full degree.
No, it was it really wasn't set up for a degree, but now it's accredited, totally accredited. And then afterwards, I went to Cornell University for the junior year.
But when you were in Deep Springs, though, there's still some other stuff, like, what did you do for recreation out there?
Recreation, I did a lot of skiing. We learned how to ski in the Sierras.
Yes.
And it was something we really thought was a lot of fun. And we went up there one time, it was 6 below 0, we had to sleep outdoors. But it was something we enjoyed a lot. And the other thing we did was take spring trips to every place. I climbed Mount Whitney. I didn't get to the top. My shoes hurt too much. And we went to the bottom of Grand Canyon where my sleeping bag caught on fire, and I sort of had to soak it in the Colorado River. We went just every place. We went all these national parks out there.
And then There was, you had an unusual Cold War experience, right?
Cold War experience, a lot of them. It was a time.
But didn't you see something?
Yeah, I saw something. I saw the testing of the atomic bomb on the Nevada flats. That we, one morning someone said, hey, they're going to have a test of the atomic bomb. Let's go to the mountain range behind the school. We went up there and, oh my gosh, if you ever see an atomic bomb explode like that, you would say it's time to stop the insanity of war.
So is that what made you decide to be a pastor?
Actually, it took a long time before I did. I remember in high school they'd take us out to eat and try to get us to be pastors or whatever. But it took quite a long time. First of all, I used to go to camp in 1950, and it was the time when they were concerned after World War II to have peace. And they told us about Jesus, the person who led people into peace, nonviolence, and love. So I sort of had a conversion. I don't know, so to this day, I don't know how it happened. But I came out of that saying, Jesus is the person I'm going to follow, and I'm going to do pacifism, peace, and love and nonviolence. That's my call. And so I had a struggle with that because at the time there was the draft, and it took a long time.
For what war?
For the Korean War. I mean, that was, I read books on that recently. It was terrible. But finally I struggled with the conscientious objector status, and finally I took the ministerial status, and that they figured ministers aren't supposed to be in wars, I don't know. But I continued my focus on peace ever since that.
Yeah, and so then you went to, for finish up your undergraduate degree, you went to
Cornell University in Ithaca. Mm-hmm. That was the last part of undergraduate work, and far above Cayuga's waters.
And then eventually you went on to...
Well, I went on to further studies, and as people who see me know, I became a pastor, and have pastored in several different places, and most recently I live here in Woodstock.
Where did you get your divinity?
Oh, degree? All places, Yale Divinity School.
Yeah, so you went from Cornell to Yale.
All Ivy League stuff, but that really doesn't count. Because the real Ivy League is college, and these are professional schools.
So do you think, was it better in the 50s, or is it better now?
Well, I would say that it was sort of scary because those atomic bombs were all around.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just the beginning of the civil rights movement in Chicago. They were sitting in, Corps and all of them, and I was following Martin Luther King even at that time. And just there was a lot of distressing things. So I think every time it has its challenge, and every time in some way it's good, and every time you just have to resist a lot of things, and you have to move ahead strongly, boldly in each time.
Very good.
Yeah.
So one last thing, like you're 87, and people, you know, they can't seem to like understand that.
Yeah.
So what do you attribute your vitality to?
Oh, there's a lot of things. I would attribute a lot of my vitality to my good wife, Susan. I've been in a lot of just the spirituality of life is just brings vitality, and things like Tai Chi and dance and art and drama, everything. You just can't let yourself down. And there are days that are really hard. I've gone through hard times, but praise God, I'm still smiling, and the joy comes every morning.
Amen.
Amen.
So the 50s were a good time.
A good time.
So happy birthday, John.
And thank you, Susan.
And happy 50s.
Happy 50s. Yeah.